Well, congratulations. I really thoroughly enjoyed the way you are bringing these characters back, because it's done in a very adult way. Is that what you guys really wanted to do? She's 43 years old. She keeps saying it.
Yeah.
I'm 43 years old, so I could...
You don't look 43. You could pass for about 35 easily.
And that was the interview. Thank you very much. That's all I needed to know. No, you wanted to tell an adult story about these beloved characters. Is that what you wanted to go for?
Yeah, I think we did. We wanted to tell a grown-up story about grown-up people because, you know, when you're in your 40s, you know, lots more things happen to you. It all gets a bit more scary in your 40s. People start dying and you start getting ill and your biological clocks run out and all of those sort of things. And if you become a mother when you're 40, you know, you get called a geriatric. And it's very much a story I related to, being a mother for the first time in my 40s. I very much related to the whole humiliation yet exhilaration of it. So there's lots more dilemmas and conflicts to take people who are older into, really.
But it's interesting though, because I always expected by the time I was 40 I was gonna know what was going on, my life would be in place, and you know, it is, you know, I'm there. But apparently you never are, right? There's always...
Absolutely. Yeah. You never evolve. Somebody asked me the other day, well, how has Bridget evolved in the 15 years since the first film? And I sort of turned the question back around. I said, how have you evolved? And he said, actually, not very much. And that's what we thought. I think she likes to think that because she's got her career sorted out, you know, she's like a top news producer, that maybe she's got lots of things sorted out. But on a personal level, I think she's still frightened of being lonely. She's, you know, still confused. She's in a worse position than she was in the first film, because now all her friends are all sorted. You know, they're settled or they're having babies and they're stay-at-home mums and dads. And she's not. She's out there swinging in the wind and, you know.
But I appreciate it on a feminist level that her professional life was in order so much, that she wasn't a klutz all the time. And that's what the adult thing for me is, and the feminist thing, that this is a woman who doesn't crave to become pregnant, but it happens to her.
Yeah.
So that's what I appreciate. How much of Emma Thompson is in there, in that story?
I think Emma, as one of the writers, there's a lot of her story in there too. We're all old mums. In this one, so
but the intelligent dealing of those issues instead of just making it a caricature.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Well, I think you know, all of the people who wrote it, you know, Helen Fielding, Emma Thompson, and Dan Mazer, all, you know, are all in those positions of, like, were late fathers and mothers, were, you know, are very aware of the kind of importance of career, but what's going on in your personal life, you know.
How were the initial conversations between you and Renee Zellweger to get her back? Because you haven't seen her in 6 years. She's obviously amazing once again in it. So how was that? Did it take a lot of convincing? How happy are you with what you've done now?
It took no convincing at all to get her to do it once we both read the new script and what the story was. We both felt it was a really strong story. It needed a bit of work, the script, but it was a strong story and I could really get behind that dilemma. It felt there was enough authenticity in it, but also enough wish fulfillment, because that's the great thing about this particular rom-com. You know, it's authentic, there's enough truth in it, but there's also a big dollop of wish fulfillment. So I think that appeals to us. There's enough physical comedy. Renee loves physical comedy, and so do I. And trying to make it authentic and motivated is kind of where we both come from.
But was it for you, like, magical to watch her slip back into that amazing performance that she gets out of that?
Yeah, there's an alchemy to it, because when she arrives, she's very much Texan Renee. And then there's lots of cups of tea and lots of talking, and then she went to work. We sent her out to work in a TV studio on a morning show, morning news show. In fact, we all went to have a look and shadow there. And then she does a lot of work with her voice coach on finding the voice. And that's mainly about where she finds the character. And then about 6 weeks after she gets here, she just, by some alchemy, she becomes Bridget. And then she stays as Bridget for the whole shoot. Yeah. She keeps the accent. She doesn't go back to Tex and Renee. And then about a minute after we say wrap, she becomes Tex and Renee again. And then we all go, what are you doing? Why are you talking like that? Come back. You know, don't leave us.
So, well, it's great to have her back. I loved seeing her again.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I love her too. And she puts so much hard work into this. So I think she nails it. Yeah. So.